Growing up, I was inspired by astronauts, and I looked at old 60s era footage of astronauts walking on the surface of the moon, and their unique combination of brains and brawn sort of inspired me to study computer science and aerospace engineering, get a pilot license, and seek to get into the space program. As I was trying to make that journey, I went to look at some of these biographies of these astronauts and often found that many of them who got to space would see the world from a new perspective and wonder, why is there war, why is there poverty, and come back to the back to ground and try to reconnect with the world and its people. I didn't go all the way, but I ended up shifting course and landed up in rural India with a very different sort of hero, the Indian small-scale farmer. Who typically cultivates less than 2 acres worth of land and earns less than $1 to $2 a day, but yet represents the second highest farm output in the world for India overall. The work of Digital Green began in 2006, initially as a part of Microsoft Research in a group looking at technology for emerging markets that Nitya also was a party to. And at the time, we were looking at what are the ways that technology could connect these rural communities with various types of expert services? At the time, one of the first MIT projects that was deploying computers and internet connectivity from 2006 was taking place. And what they found, though, was that although these computers and connectivity were being deployed, they were running into all sorts of challenges from access as well as accessibility of local languages, to the whole gamut of rural development challenges, ranging from lack of electricity, to road access, to market access, which made it the case that even though we were sitting at Microsoft and we were thinking about what is the role of technology, we couldn't just focus on the technology piece alone. We needed to think about these issues of rural development in a much more comprehensive manner. Now, many organizations, especially the government, as well as civil society and even the private sector, have tried to address this challenge of how do you get expert information to farmers to boost their productivity and increase their nutrition and quality of life by essentially building armies of frontline workers, community health workers, community agricultural extension workers, who are tasked with traversing difficult to cross terrain and diverse farmers of a varying language and agroecological and other persuasions to be able to convince them to adopt new types of technologies or practices on their own farms. The government of India actually has one of the highest, largest extension forces in the world with over 200,000 extension agents, but the government of India's own survey in 2005 found that the formal extension workers were reaching a proportionally small number of farmers. What was the most effective way in which information was being shared amongst these farming communities was the farmers themselves, sharing information with their neighbors and with their family members about what crops they grew and how they grew them, as well as those folks who would be selling these farmers various types of inputs like seeds, fertilizers, and pesticides and the like. And so when we started this work, we thought, well, video might make sense in agricultural extension. Now, that's not particularly novel. The government of India itself has been running broadcast television programs for farmers for the last 70 years. But what's different is with the commoditization of camcorders and pico projectors, this whole process of producing and sharing knowledge can now be done at a grassroots level and realize some significant resource savings in terms of human cost and time. And where the going mantra for agricultural extension or the training of farmers or improved practices is seeing is believing, video makes some sense. Now, it's one thing to say that video makes some sense. It's another thing to institutionalize it within the context of an existing grassroots level agricultural development program. So for the first 6 months, we just spent time immersed in these rural communities, conducting ethnographic research, and just being with a local organization, working with these communities, and seeing really how can video perhaps be embedded to support the work that they were already doing. So some of the things that we looked at were, who should be featured in these videos? You can get a great lecture from a university scientist or from a government officer. But for farmers who see these videos, they see a large socioeconomic, geographic, educational disconnect between those individuals and themselves. In the so-called Green Revolution era, there was a focus on progressive farmers, those farmers who are richer and more risk capable. But what we found is that farmers wanted to hear from similar farmers to themselves, average and marginalized farmers, and even landless farmers, who were similarly resource constrained and were trying these practices from themselves and could inspire these other farmers to take up these practices for themselves. A next question is, once you build out a library of videos, is how do you go about distributing it? So initially, we tried distributing these videos over local village cable networks. This was in South India, so a fair share of TV penetration and cable access existed even back in 2006. And we even tried Netflix-style VCD exchanges where people could watch videos at their own will on their own television sets. But very quickly, we realized that farmers would have questions about which video should I watch? What if I need access to an input or a market to really get value from this information that's being shared with me? There was also the fact that this initial curiosity factor of say, looking at videos started to die out very quickly without sort of these connections actually taking place for farmers to get ultimate impact and value from them. And what we found was really important was to have a human facilitator in the loop, of somebody who could be present at the time that these videos were being shown to these farmer groups and be able to engage the communities into discussion, asking questions, getting feedback, and then providing follow-up support as needed to help these farmers translate information into action and value. So over the years, this work started in 2006, we produced through our network of communities and partners across 9 countries in South Asia and Africa, 5,000 videos in about 50 different languages. These videos span a variety of different types, from demonstrations of agricultural practices and techniques to testimonials about how to access markets or government schemes. And the main feature, though, is really featuring these local individuals as the stars in these videos to reduce that disconnect between insiders and outsiders. In this case, the people who watch the videos are very much from the same communities who appear in the videos. And we find that some farmers are even incentivized to adopt these practices just to be featured on video, to be seen as role models within their respective communities. The way that this content is produced, obviously in these communities that have limited electricity and internet connectivity, is essentially a hub and spoke model, where in each district where we operate, a team of 4 to 6 individuals from the local community is trained to produce these videos for themselves, using just basic pocket video cameras, storyboarding out these videos, using Windows Movie Maker and the like to be able to edit them, and then distribute these videos after they've been vetted by some technical experts to ensure their quality in their local area. And so if you're a farmer watching these videos, about 80% of the videos that you'd be watching would be from within your same district. And just about 20% of the videos might be coming from across, because we find that the biggest impact that comes from the videos is not the technical part about the step-by-step demonstration of this or that practice, but really that aspirational value that is afforded by these videos, where farmers are able to see their peers benefiting from these practices, becoming better farmers as a result, and themselves feeling that they can too, essentially changing how they even perceive themselves and their own self-confidence in the process. Behind the scenes, we have a variety of different types of technology platforms that I wanted to just share quickly with you, as we've scaled up this approach now to about 10,000 villages and 1.5 million farmers, 80% of whom, I should mention, are women. We have 3 types of technology solutions that make this scaling possible, that I've kind of segmented into 3 categories: targeting, empowering, and connecting. Targeting, you can think of as essentially like a Google Analytics for our videos, in that although these videos are being screened offline, we're collecting data at every video screening about who watched what video, what questions they asked, and what practices they did or did not do afterwards. And each farmer, each of these 1.5 million farmers, is watching 1 new video every 2 weeks in sync with the cropping season and the like. And so what we can see are trends, like what's the most popular video at a particular time or place, what's the least popular practice that people may do once or perhaps drop the subsequent season. We've also assembled these videos, that all the videos are available on YouTube, of course, and we get a high degree of visitorship online nowadays as mobile internet access expands. But what we've done on our website is basically to create a layer on top of the YouTube site to organize these videos based on crop, seasonality, language, and link in the data about how these videos were utilized, how many people watched them on and offline, how many people adopted these practices ultimately, and what were the qualitative questions that people asked, which might inform a new video based on frequently asked questions, for instance. As access has been expanding, we've also been pushing on trying to enable the communities themselves to self-service themselves and watch these videos at their own volition. So with some colleagues at Microsoft Research, we developed an app that is which tries to minimize text and is basically a text-free user interface for enabling rural communities to search and browse through this video content based on pictorial representations of video content as well as audio cues that they can sort of browse through. And given like the limitations of connectivity, we also had ways so that people don't have to stream necessarily the whole video, but can just watch, for instance, the keyframes of the content that might be of use to them. Alongside that, we have a leaderboard of the farmers that we work with. As I mentioned, we have all this data that we collect and are able to do a Google Analytics type of play of looking at trends of what's popular and what's not. We also are able to create leaderboards of the farmers themselves to see which farmers are adopting more or less of these practices and how does that compare with their peers, and how do the community agriculture and health workers that work with them, how are they performing, and who's doing better or worse than their peers, to kind of expose this often black box of rural development online, and so that you can see, you know, who's interacting with whom, and perhaps bridge these communities who are sometimes even disconnected with themselves. So we built out a tool called Farmer Book, which is basically a Facebook of the farmers that we work with, where you can see a timeline activity feed of, say, this one individual woman over the course of time about what videos she watched, what practices she applied or didn't apply, and what questions did she ask, and how did that compare with her peers as a way to bring these women together, to share best practices with one another and ask, why did one woman perhaps adopt a practice and one didn't? Is there an opportunity for exchange there? We've also linked that farmer book sort of timeline to Facebook itself so that people who are online, mostly urban and middle class types of folks, so that they can bridge this world, these two worlds that are often and increasingly disconnected of the rural communities and the online urban communities. And here you can, for instance, follow an individual farmer and her progress over time. We've gone further to try to put an entertainment spin onto this by creating a Facebook game called Wonder Village, which is kind of like a Farmville-esque kind of game, where you build a virtual village economy, you play with your Facebook friends, but along the way, you connect with these village gurus who turn out to be the same farmers that we work with offline in these rural communities. Another attempt in this direction was a reality TV show program that we co-produced in India with a major station there. And it was a kind of a cross between Amazing Race meets Apprentice, 13 episode series, 15 college age contestants traveling across India by bus doing challenges like setting up drip irrigation kits or preparing meals with local millets, and getting kicked off each episode until we had finally the green champion. And again, the idea was primarily targeted towards like these urban audiences. However, we also found spillover benefits for the rural communities themselves as they started to feel that, oh, people in Bombay and Delhi care about agriculture. That changes how I even see agriculture. It no longer becomes something as a last resort, and the only thing that I see in mainstream media is about like farmer suicides. There's actually something, perhaps, you know, maybe there's a source of prosperity in this vocation as well. As in addition to empowering, we've also found that as we've been growing out this network of farmers who are kind of connected through these various types of digital media, that there's also opportunities to provide additional value. So about 2 years ago, we started up a service called Loop, which is basically a shared transport to market service. It's essentially like a Uber carpool for vegetable produce, where farmers can make pickup requests for their perishable horticulture produce on any given day. We batch those requests for pickups against a roster of nearby transporters of varying carrying capacity and route them to make these pickups, move that produce to nearby wholesale market, and pay these farmers back on the same day, now increasingly through digital money as some of this expands in its penetration. And so just to kind of conclude, we think of our work as sort of a stacked intervention, right? There's the farmers themselves, they have their informal social networks that they already have and which they already use to exchange information with one another. Then we partner with organizations, government, civil society, private entities, who have these field forces, who organize community groups, women's self-help groups, and other types of institutions, and who have those frontline workers that really have that regularity of interaction, which is so key for trust. And then we introduce the digital tools of information sharing in the form of videos, as well as collecting data and feedback from these communities to inform and target that those programs more efficiently. And as we do so, we then find new opportunities to leverage that stack to sometimes connect with other types of audience groups, whether they be urban, middle class, connected types of folks, or to link these rural communities to markets, which in a previous era may have been done through formal cooperatives or producer companies, which you can now do using some of these digital tools and shared economy types of plays. So finally, you know, we sometimes think of the so-called digital divide as something that's going to be crossed by technology alone. But the reality is there's all these other components of physical infrastructure, human capital, finance, political institutions that are necessary foundational blocks before you can bring in some component of digital technology, whether that be video, whether that be, you know, transportation service. And that's why we found it so key to partner with local organizations and communities who have aligned objectives and intentions. And that's then when technology can really amplify the effectiveness of these programs and broaden the participation of the communities at the same time, in much the same way that I was inspired by these astronauts to study science and engineering. We can also use these digital tools then to change how farmers can take their own one small step toward improving their lives and those around them. Thank you.